And now, without any further ado, please help me welcome my pastor as she comes. Give her a hearty amen.
Well, it's a good day. Yes. No matter what the devil says, it's a good day. Yes, I love the Lord tonight. I mean, today. Appreciate him for all that he has done for us. It's a privilege to be in the house of the Lord, to worship him in spirit and in truth. He always does so many beautiful things. In spite of all the chaos that we witnessed this week, God is still in control. He's still in control. I was thinking I'm going to talk about it on the show this week, but I thought everybody's trying to figure out for some reason why all this happened. And I thought, is that complicated at all? It's not complicated. They're saying it's this thing, it's that thing. And I'm thinking, there is one thing that's the problem with this whole issue. And that thing is, if I do wrong and you punish me, if somebody else do wrong, you punish them, there's no need to make noise. The noise comes from the fact that the person who hurt somebody, they just walked away. If you murder somebody, you should go to prison. But that doesn't matter whether you're a police officer, whether you're just a regular citizen, you should go to prison. But I am convinced that the outcry is, we want everybody treated the same. So if you've done it, if I've done it, I had to go to jail. Why didn't, when you did it, you didn't? And I was sitting there thinking to myself, God, thank you for justice. Because that's who he is. He is justice. I don't care which one of us in here do something wrong, from me to every person sitting out there, God's going to deal with it. And he's not going to be nicer to one than he is to the other. He's going to treat us all the same. How bad we need that in this country. I said, this is not a problem. Let's deal with the root cause. And the professor that was on the show Tuesday night said, this is not a black issue. This is a white issue. And it's because if blacks do it, we punish for it. But if the whites do it, they don't get punished. What's wrong with that picture? Something's wrong with it. And I said, Lord, I'm so glad that I can look to you and depend on you. We're not going to stand in his presence not one time and he'd give us anything that's unjust, because he's a just God and he's always looking out for our benefit. I am thankful this morning for his blessings, for all that he's doing. And I think we make things seem so complicated. Just if you keep pushing, and killing people, somebody's going to stand up and say, when are you going to stop? When are you going to stop? When do what we are in this country? We have contributed much to America. At least give us the right to explore that and not be shoved aside. It's a tragedy. And every time I see it, I'm just sickened by it. I think, God, this is so horrible. And it doesn't have to be this way. And until the hearts of men change toward each other, it'll always be there. It'll always be there until you start at least accepting the fact that, you know what, everybody has a right to justice. Everybody, no matter who you are. And I am thankful this morning that God looks out for us, takes care of us in spite of. And I know without a doubt, we got to do our part. We got to pray. We got to make our voices known to people. Take a look. And let's not be alarmed. And I thought to myself, this killing of men didn't even happen in Dallas, but they got the fallout of it. That's when you can't say, when I say it, it ain't affecting nobody but me. No, it affects other people. And so way over here it takes place, but then it ends up in Dallas with even a worse situation. We need to be careful what we do and think that whose lives is this going to affect? Because it's going to affect somebody. And we need to take thought for that. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Samuel, the 6th chapter. Father, I'm grateful this morning for your blessings, for being so good and so kind. I thank you because you never failed us. You loved us more than anybody in the whole world. I pray now, God, that you would anoint your servant, that I might deliver to your people that which you've given to me. And we'll give you glory and we'll give you honor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. The sixth verse says, the ark of the Lord was in the country of the Philistines 7 months. And the Philistines called for the priest and the diviner, saying, what shall we do to the ark of the Lord? Tell us wherewith we shall send it to his place. And they said, if you send away the ark of God of Israel, send it not empty, but in any wise return him a trespass offering, then you shall be healed, and it shall be known to you why his hand is not removed from you. Then said they, what shall be the trespass offering which we shall return to him? And they answered, 5 golden emeralds, 5 golden mice, according to the number of the lords of the Philistines, for one plague was on you all and on your lords. Wherefore you shall make images of your emeralds and images of your mice that mar the land. And you shall give glory to the God of Israel. Peradventure he will lighten his hand from off you and from off your gods. Now, I want to get to something, cut this short because I don't want to be so long and maybe talk my way through the rest. But I'm looking at some people here that's trying to figure out, how do we get the Ark of God back to Israel? Because it's been left here and it stayed there 7 months. Now, if you understand the power of the ark was that the Ten Commandments were in there. And it always symbolized the presence of God no matter what. So it was a dangerous thing for just not anybody better not mess with that ark. People have been slain because they messed with it. Things happen to people as a result of it. So they're saying, we got this ark sitting here. How are we going to move it? What are we going to do with it? So they inquired and got information that says, okay, this is how you do it. You better not send it empty to him. And you better not, and for sure, you had better offer up a trespass offering, saying to God, we're sorry for what we did. Because if you tend to move this without dealing with the fact that we trespassed, we did what was wrong, and now I got to figure out what to do. And the priest says, offer up a trespass offering. You need to say, God, I'm sorry for what I've done. I think sometimes as I look around in this world, I am alarmed about the fact that there's not a lot of people that fear God. But these people were afraid. They knew what the consequences could be. And they say, so what do we do? How do we present it? It's been sitting there 7 months. It's a curse on them while it's sitting there. And the only way you're going to clear this up, you better repent. And I say that to every person this morning. We need people that have the fear of God in their life. There's no fear of God in the land. That's why people do what they do. If you fear God, you be careful how you walk, what you say, and how you do it. But if you don't fear God, you might do anything. And without even thinking about it. I was thinking this morning, from the time I was a little girl, there was just things you didn't do because we were taught the fear of God. That you just don't say this, you just don't do that. And all these things telling us, you better be careful. You have to walk lightly before God. I thought about my daughter's little puppy, Socks. And he's scared to death when it thunders and lightning. I mean, wherever he's at, he's going to tear it down getting in there. To somebody, because I don't know what this is, but it's not normal. When we were kids, and it would start thundering and lightning, my grandmother would say, get somewhere and sit down and be quiet. God is at work. We understood that thundering and lightning meant something. If you understand the word of God, it's plainly telling you the lightning is the flashing of God's eyes. That's some serious flashing, let me tell you. And the thunder is his voice. So when you look at the sky and you see this, you understand. I don't care what scientists call it. I say the word calls it God's eyes is the lightning and the thunder is his voice. So we got quiet to minute it started thundering and light, we found a place where we could sit down and not make no noise, be quiet. What they were teaching us was to reference God. What they were teaching us, he is a God to be feared. We just can't think and do anything any way we want to without consequences for. You know, under the law, God moved a lot quicker, and then he was somewhat lenient in a way. But only lenient in a way because they weren't under grace. Jesus had not yet come. Every year they had to go and offer up sacrifices for their sins. But so the scripture says at these times, it's what God winked at. So in other words, I would do it to you, but because the blood is not there yet, because my son has not come yet, then I'm a little bit more lenient. But yet he struck people down in spite of it. So you got to ask yourself, do I really fear God? Because if you did, you wouldn't do the stuff you're doing. See, I want people to understand that the fear of the Lord prolongeth your days, but the years of the wicked shall be shortened. But if you fear God, it guarantees you a longer life, because you ain't going to put yourself in no bad situation and situations where you can't get out of that could cost you your life. It'll prolong your life if you fear God. But if you don't fear God, you got to understand you might do any and everything and not think about it until God brings judgment on you. So when I look at this, I'm saying, okay, what brought all this about? The scripture says because he doesn't execute judgment quickly, it is set in the hearts of men to continue to sin. It's set in their hearts to continue. Well, God ain't going to do it. Because you think you're getting away, but you're not. There should be such reverence for God in this hour that even coming to church, we ought to be careful how we enter his house. Some of that stuff is so far out there, just not there. You know, we don't think about it. You know, walk into church and whatever comes and go talk about it and everything. The fear of God will hold you in check. It'll keep you from saying or doing things you shouldn't do. And it'll keep you from thinking a bunch of crazy stuff because God knows what your thoughts are. So he said, no, don't do that. He's trying to put man in a position, if you understand it, is that I want you to walk before me, but fear me. Love me. Reference me. Don't be so quick to just say and do any and everything, and because God's going to hold you accountable, and he will judge you for sin. So the more I looked at this, I thought about, this is one example of that. They were transferring the ark again. And David at first left it down in the house of Obedim, left it there for some months. And somebody told him how blessed he was. David said, I'm going down and get that ark. You know, I'm going to get it, but how I'm going to bring it back? Because Obedim getting blessed, I'm getting that ark and bring it back. So he went to get it, and he took Uzzah with him and some others. And it says, when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen shook it. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error. Now, this was a mistake. And there he died by the ark of God. That's how much power it was. Don't just touch it. And David got a little bit irritated with God because he did that. He thought, now, God, come on here. I mean, the ark was about to fall. And all he did was push it, behold it, so it wouldn't fall. So God didn't answer him. He didn't answer him. But he knew nobody's supposed to touch the ark except the high priest. And it was the place of the holy. So that's a holy thing. Nobody hardly in this generation sitting in this building this morning would be able to touch it. You got to walk in a certain place to have that kind of a power and be able to move on a certain thing and not do it wrong. But as I reached out to try to hold it to keep it from falling, and God killed him. God can send you a message you will never forget. Something happened to you that he will send you a message. Don't forget it. Don't ever try this again. Because if you do, you're going to deal with the consequences of it. So if this is under the law, and there, I mean, the ark, as far as this day is concerned, is not like the ark was in that day. It represents the presence of God, but it all in our day, it still represents the presence of God. See, so we ought to be careful what we say, how we say it, and who we say it to. Let me think before I speak. I remember my husband's father. He was a wicked man. And he lived with this woman, Bernice. And he was around saying that he gonna see if God is bad enough to come down here and face him. And he said, he's going on talking about God. And, well, you know what? I don't care what he thinks anyway. He was talking all kind of crap. Well, the woman he's living with said, let me get away from around this fool because God gonna kill this fool. She wasn't even saved. She said, I'm getting out of the way from around you because God gonna kill this man, talking to God, inviting God to kiss his blankety blank. And I'm telling you, she moved. She said, no. She wasn't even saved, had a fear of God. What's wrong with people that say they're saved and don't have none? What is it? And so when I looked at that, I'm thinking, God, in this hour, we need to be sure we bring to the table what it means to walk in the fear of God. That I'm going to be careful what I say, who I say it about. You know, in our day, I don't care if we didn't have a lot of preachers that was messed up the way you see them today, but people were careful what they said about a preacher. They were careful how they carried themselves. Of course, they don't deserve that anymore, many of them, because they're not doing anything. But when I looked at that, I'm thinking, God, we were careful. We had to sit a certain way. Be quiet when the preacher is there. You don't get involved in all these other things. You sit down and you keep your mouth out of respect. Now, not many of them is deserving of respect, but there's still some that do. And so when I look at that, I'm thinking, God, bring back the days when man knows who you are and what you could do to him if he don't do the right thing. Don't just keep on pushing it aside and I don't think that was bad. Be careful what you say when you come in his presence. Be careful how you carry yourself every day. Every day means I'm going to do it right, because if I don't, God's going to judge me for it. He's going to judge me for it. So what am I going to do? I'm going to be sure that I walk in the place where he would have me to walk. Vitally, vitally important. Because let me tell you, take you to another story. And it's when the Hebrew women, this takes you all the way back to the Egyptian Pharaoh the king. He didn't like it the way Israel was multiplying. He said, they keep multiplying like this, they're going to end up, we ain't going to be able to pull them under. They're going to be more than us. So he says to them, I tell the midwives who delivered the babies, tell them every man child that's born, kill it upon his birth. And so the midwives, this is what it says, but the midwives feared God and did not as the king of Egypt had commanded them, but saved the men children alive. We're not doing that. We're not going to be guilty of murder, killing babies because Pharaoh wants us to do it. We ain't doing it. It's not many people stop today and say, no, you want me to do something wrong? I'm not going to do that. I have a fear of God that I got to do it right. Otherwise, I pay the price for it. So they said, no, we're not doing it. So then the king of Egypt, he said unto Pharaoh, this, he said, why have ye done this thing and have saved the men children alive? And the midwife said unto Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are lively. and are delivered ere the midwives come in unto them. He said, well, here's what the midwife says. Well, they're not like the Egyptian women. Take them a long time to deliver. So we know, we can carry on what you say. But the women of God, they come in, they just have a baby like that. And so before we can do anything, before we ever get there to deliver the child is born already. So, but what kept them was the fact, I fear God. I'm not going to kill these babies. I don't care if the king did say it. I don't care if the preacher did tell you something wrong. I don't care if he did condone and stay by your side and support you in your wrong. Don't you do it. If you fear God, you won't do it. See? Now, the midwives, it says, therefore God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and waxed very mighty. And it came to pass, because the midwives feared God, that he made them houses. I'm going to give you a place to live. If you do what God tells you to do, it always brings a reward. And if you don't do what he says do, it always brings judgment. You can't get around it. God, it is saying a lot when people say, I'm going to do what I believe is right. It may not go along with everybody else, but I'm going to do what's right. Somebody on your job may want you to stand and fight against a worker there and tell lies on them and say, we need you to help us. I'm not doing it. Why? Because I fear God. I fear God enough to know I shouldn't be doing a wrong to somebody who has not done wrong. I should not speak against a person who has done nothing. And stand with the group that's telling the lies. You shouldn't do that. You better fear God, because if you don't fear God, judgment comes to you. You cannot get around it. You better take a look at yourself and say, do I really fear God? No, most people don't. In fact, they don't even think he's real. They don't even think he's real. So you got to stop for a minute and say, where do I fit into this picture? How do I feel? And then if I come around one of God's leaders, I'm careful. Careful. What I say, how I carry myself, that you don't say or do something you shouldn't say or do. Out of reverence for God, this is his leader. This is his leader. Therefore, I better be sure that I reverence them with fear. Understand, God don't play when it comes to his leaders. It's like, don't you do that. If you do, I will get you. There were some kids in the Bible, and you might say, well, this is very cruel. It ain't cruel. Elijah was going up to pray, and some kids, 42 little kids, was laughing at him and making fun of him. They said, go on up, you old bald head. God said, you're not going to do that to my leader. So what did he do? He sent two female bears out of the woods. And they ate up all 42 children. Teaching you a lesson, teaching your family a lesson. That's why we ought to teach our kids, you need to fear God. Be careful what you say. Because God's going to get you and I can't help you. I can't help you to keep him from getting you. You better deal with that. Somebody look at and say, well, he let kids, 42 little innocent kids, they wasn't innocent. They're calling the man of God, you old bald head, and laughing at him, making fun of him. God said, that's not going to happen. You're not going to make fun of my leader, and you're not going to tell them, give them some words or whatever you want to speak to them. You better not do that. You're not going to call him a name, and I let you do it. See, all these things that happen in the Word is for our example. It's saying to you, remember? Remember when God did this? Remember when he did that? You better be careful. You better be careful. As Gamaliel in the New Testament said to them when the apostles, they were constantly beating up on the apostles. And he said, let me tell y'all something. He told them different stories. This man did it. He came to naught. This one did it. I will tell you, leave these men alone. For if this thing be of God, God, you can't overthrow it anyway. And if it's not of God, it ain't gonna stay anyway. But if it's of God, stay back from it. We got too many people who won't do that. You know, we just want to run our mouth about everything. Yeah, I don't believe this, and I don't think you should do this. I say, look, be quiet. The word says study to be quiet. Study that. Somebody talk to you about somebody. If that person is a woman or man of God, you better close a deaf ear and say, let me get out of here. I shouldn't be hearing this. Because I'm not going to be the one who carry the lie or the story. I'm not going to be the one. Why? Because what will it cost me? It could cost you your life. I told you about the story at home where this woman's baby was born with one eye. And he couldn't see out of that one. And that's why people ought to be careful getting mad with God. I hear people say, I got mad with God. I thought you were insane. You were insane. And she said, she told the Lord, why is my baby born with one eye? The neighbors down the street, they had a baby. It was perfectly normal. And what have I done that you would let my baby be born with one eye? She had another baby. It was born with two eyes, but couldn't see nothing. He cursed every baby she had down the line because you have the nerve to call me in question. You're going to say, why did God let this happen? I hear this from people a lot. I don't know why God let this happen to me. Are you kidding me? Every problem man got in his life, he did it. He did it to himself. God has not in any way done you wrong. He ain't never done us nothing but good. So I can't charge God foolishly. When Job's wife got upset with him because of all the wrong things coming, and I said, why don't you just curse God and die? He said, you talk like a foolish woman. Shall not we receive good and evil both from the hand of God? And you want me to curse him? You talk like a fool. That's what you need to tell people who's talking like a fool to you. Why don't you just do this and do that? You better be careful where you tread and who you are treading it with. For just a moment. And say, you know what? I got to be careful that I don't say anything that would be wrong. When we suffer a lot of loss in our lives and children and what have you, Job never did charge God foolishly with all that happened to him. And you got people, one thing go wrong in their life, on the job or wherever it may be, and they want to know why God is allowing this. Then they'll say, if God's such a loving God, why does he allow these people to kill people? God's not in that killing. You better deal with the fact that sin is to blame for that. God is not to blame for all the violence and all the stuff that we see. The devil is using people to destroy other people's lives, and they didn't turn to God. When they don't, we pay the consequences for it. Give yourself to God that you might not get messed up. We're living in a dangerous world, very dangerous. There's violence on every hand. It's unbelievable. Since that thing happened with these two men, they've had shootings in different parts of the country. And I was reading about the man in Missouri. A policeman went up, it was a traffic stop, and he got the man's license and what have you and went back to his car. And the man who he's writing a ticket for got out the car and went back to where he was and just shot him 3 times. He said, oh, that sounds so bad. God didn't do that. No, no, no. When man don't serve God, he might do anything. He might do anything. The hatred that's in the world has nothing to do with God. God is love. 100% love. He's not in that. Quit blaming God for things that if you would have done your life different, it may not have turned out that way. If you'd have made him number one in your life, it may not have turned out that way. Quit blaming God for your bad situations. Your man, most of his bad situations is one of his own making. He did it to himself. Job wasn't going to let anybody stop him. He said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And he worshiped him. He didn't talk against God. He worshiped him. Something you can say against God will cost you your life. Because sometimes this just throw your whole life into a tailspin. You got to stop for a minute and say, wait a minute. What's going on? And I prayed and prayed that God still didn't hear my prayer. It's not true. He hears every prayer. But whether or not he answers you depends on where you are. That's exactly what it is. Where are you? Do you expect God to give you the answer and okay everything for you? He don't okay everything for the righteous. So stop for a minute. Some things are going to happen. We have no control over it, and we already know it's going to happen. Take a look. Take a look. So if anybody's sitting in this room this morning and you got this little issue with God, if you will, it's just something I just could never get over. I could see how God could let that happen to my son, to my daughter. It's the wrong person to be angry with. You know what? He don't owe us nothing. He don't owe us today what he's doing for us right now. Therefore, when I look up, I just want to say thank you for all that you've done. You've been good to us in spite of. You've got me through situations that you didn't even have to get me through. You've done things for me and raised me up when you didn't have to. You walk with me. You talk with me. You made a way so that I could get through it. And so what am I talking about? Because in actuality, God never owed us nothing. Nothing. When he gave his son to give his life, he didn't owe us that. But because he loved us so much, he said he gave his only begotten son. Because I love you. And we walk around talking, I don't even know if God cares about me. Well, I think if you don't have it by now, you never will have it. I mean, the fact you sitting on a pew this morning and didn't die and go to hell over the weekend or during the course of a week. What about that? The fact that you got your health and strength and you can move around and take care of yourself. What about that? The fact that you went to work all last week and came back home, back and forth, and didn't get in an accident. What about that? But you want to blame him for wrong? I hate that. I hate it. And when somebody say it, I take offense to it. Are you kidding me? You think God is at fault here? He's not at fault. Think for a minute, I'm not going to allow the enemy to use me in my mind or whatever to do anything that would somehow cause God to move against me in his anger. And he will do it. So we got to say, you know what, I need to check my life and pull it in, and I need to be careful what I say. You hear people use profanity now. He says, thou shalt not take the Lord thy God's name in vain. You don't use that. And you hear people use the curse words, the language, using his name. Dangerous. At any moment, just because it didn't happen to this person doesn't mean it won't happen to you. At any moment, he could turn the tables. At any moment, I'm going to stop you. At any moment, the thing you thought you was going to get through with, I'm not going to let it happen for you. Because you have no reverence. You don't reverence God. He is my everything. I don't come in this church. If I come in this church all by myself and nobody's here, I am fully aware I am in God's house. I'm not just going to say and do anything, talk about any and everything in God's house. Even in my home. It's like you want to be careful what your conversation is. What kind of words do you use? It should still be sanctified. It still should be holy because God is everywhere. He is in my house. He's in the church. He's when you go down the street, he is there. He said one time he's the unseen guest everywhere. So when I think, let me think, how did I think? When when Simon thought that, I think it was Simon, who thought that that the gift of God could be bought with money. Because he saw the apostles laying hand on people and see all these things. It's almost like he was treating it like it's a magic thing. You know, how much money can I give for this magic y'all got? And Paul said, you need to repent and ask God to forgive you for the fact that you even thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You should take a look at that. You need to repent. You ain't getting ready to lay hands on nobody for no money. And a lot of preachers are doing that today. They walk around and tell you what God's going to do for you if you give them $100. And if you kept your $100, you'd be better off. All this stuff they tell you that God's going to do this and he's going to do that and got people's hopes all up and stuff. And then they turn around, well, I did this for God. The preacher told me so and so. And look what happened to me. Don't blame God for a lying preacher. If he lied to you, don't blame God, for God is not a liar. He said, I'm not man that I should lie, neither the son of man that I should repent. So if some preacher lied to you, don't come get mad with God. It never did happen. I think it was Joyce Meyer that had said something to this lady about giving or whatever and how God was going to do different things for her, and none of them happened. So she went back to the meeting and told Joyce Meyer, give me my money back. And said, you're not going to get your money. Give me my money back, because ain't nothing you told me was going to happen has happened. So in other words, you lied. You better be very conscious of lying preachers in this hour. We'll tell you anything for you to put a dollar in the offering plate. Understand, it's not about that. It's not about money. It is about whether or not I walk before God, reverence him, and speak the truth in my heart and don't lie. What happened with Ananias and Sapphira? You know the story. That they went in and they, back in the day of the early church, they always sold so much every year of their goods and what have you and brought it to the church so that people that had needs, everybody would have all things equal. That's what they how they did it in that day. And Ananias and Sapphira conspired together to lie to Peter and tell Peter that we sold the land for this, because it looked like when we sell it, tell them we sold it for this and we give this, it looked like we really giving big. But when they went in because of the Holy Ghost, you better be careful. When you're talking to a man, a woman of God that's really with him, you're not lying just to that preacher. You have set yourself to lie to God that's in that preacher. So Peter said to him, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? Why have you done it? Because here's Ananias telling the lie. 3 hours, he dropped dead in the church. 3 hours later, his wife come in with the same lie. She dropped dead. You know what the message is? Don't lie to God. And men will still do it to this day. You ask them a question. I know as a pastor, I have to say, think. Think about what I'm getting ready to tell you. Because man's first inkling is the start line. Say, wait a minute. Don't wait. I'm going to ask you a question. I have run into so many folks that lie in the church. Every time I got something I got to say to you, now tell the truth. What I'm getting ready to ask you, tell the truth. If you don't want them ahead of time, immediately. Oh, no, Sister Rose, I would never do that. Oh, no, Sister Rose, that's not me. That is you. That is you. And I think that's the thing that God did to Ananias and Sapphira. Is that not a wake-up call? Don't lie, and surely don't go into church and tell a lie to the leader. You didn't have to lie. Peter said, was it not in your own power to do with it whatever you wanted to give whatever you wanted to give? You didn't have to come in here and lie. I've seen so many people that lie just to lie. There's never a reason to lie, but I'm alarmed at the people that start lying for no reason. It ain't because they're trying to save themselves or nothing, just lying. And I just go back. I said, I'm going to ask you this again. Did you or did you not do such and such? Well, the way they almost sound like politicians. You never get a direct answer from a politician. Every time they say to any of these politicians, well, what do you think about this? They're going way over here, back over here, and back here. And most reporters now are saying to them, you didn't answer the question. You took me down K cross L up M and everything else, but I need the answer. I don't want to know this long story you got. Did you or did you not? That's where we, I was looking at Hillary Clinton being interviewed by, I think it was Wolf on CNN. He asked her a question. Do you feel the same way? He come back again and say, but do you feel the same way? You're not going to get me to agree. I'm going to walk around. I'm sitting there telling you, answer the question. How do y'all just walk around stuff? It is constant. They was interviewing Cory Booker last week or week before. Because he's supposed to be on the short list for Hillary Clinton VP. And so the woman said to Corey, so are you on the short list for vice president? He waited for me. They always wait. Well, I can't really say that I'm on the short list. He said, well have they vetted you yet? He came up with something else. I thought, boy, you a politician. He never answered. And the reporter said at the end, I see that you're not going to answer that question. No. And that's just the way church people do. I'm telling you, you say that you do such and such? Yeah. Did you do such and such? Well, the way this happened was, I don't want to hear that. I don't need a story. I just need an answer. How difficult is that? If you're telling the truth, it's not difficult. But if you're lying about it, a liar's always thinking, you know, like, what, you know, can I come up with this, you know? And I'm still saying, go ahead. And sometimes I ask them something, and they say, well, I was trying to think. I said, you don't have to think about that. What I just asked you, it don't require thought. You know whether you did that or not. If you fear God and you ask a question, just from Ananias and Sapphira, she say, I ain't lying about it. I'm going to tell the truth. Even if it makes me look bad, because you are bad. It just makes you look bad. You are bad. You when you want to look like that, it's because you are like that. Sometimes I can get very tired when I'm talking to people and they keep telling me something else. Sometimes I'll hang up the phone. If one of my kids around, I say, well, I just got off the phone with a liar. I'll get back with him. So I'll come back later. You remember when I had that phone call with you the other day? Such a thing? Yes, ma'am. Did you do that? Oh, let me explain to you what happened. I don't need an explanation. Because there's never going to be a reason to justify what you did. You can't change it. Say, I stole something, but Sister Rose, I didn't have no bread. The word don't give any places where you said, okay, you can lie if you need to do this. Or if you need to go steal something, just tell them you stole it because you was hungry. The word won't give you that. Because you know what David said? I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed beg bread. He said, wait a minute. What are you talking about? You're a child of God and you don't have nothing to eat? No, that doesn't happen. I said, really? No. You see people living on the street? That's not the way God treats people. That's the way our society treats people. My daughter was telling me her and Jeanette was going to see the guys yesterday, and she said, Mama, this woman was sitting outside the store in the heat, and she had a big bottle of water and had a little granddaughter with her that was 11, and she had something to drink too. Yeah, and so they said, ma'am, do you need some help? And she said, well, I've been living in my car for the last few days, and this is my granddaughter, because my daughter's in prison, and they sitting there on the ground with some water. And one said, well, and she said, but it's too hot to sleep in the car. So one said, well, let me give you some money, go get you a room at the hotel, and so you can, you know, get some rest, you and your little granddaughter. The little girl stood up and said, Mom, Grandma, yes, let's go get the room. And do you know when she went in the store, the other man in the store said, ma'am, can I talk to you for a minute? I said, yes. Did she ask you for something? Well, I said, I gave her something because that's what I wanted to do. Oh, okay. So in other words, if she asks you for something, we're going to get her away from in front of this store. Well, you got enough stuff in that store to feed her. You got enough stuff in there to do something about it. And then you ain't going to do it, and you don't want her to do something? You don't tell me what to do. If I want to help somebody, well, you don't never know. Some of these people are just bums. Well, you're a bum. Somebody put up with you somewhere in your life bumming around. If I want to do it, that's my business. They tried to pass a law here, and it didn't get off the ground good, that you don't give no homeless people any money or anything. I thought, now you are stepping over the line. If this is my money, and this is what I want to do, when are you going to tell me who I can help and who I can't help? People can talk cold and uncaring all over the place. They don't have no fear of God. If I was hungry, did you feed me? When I was in prison, did you come see me? I don't know who you are because you know I don't relate to you. Just want to walk around, call ourselves Christian, and just walk past people that suffer and think nothing about it? No, I'm going to help these people. I will not pass anybody. If it's in a position where I can get out of the car and traffic's not moving, I'm going to get out that car and give them something. I don't care. Look, this man was standing on the corner in Denver, and this has been a while because I don't go nowhere anymore, but this man was standing on the corner. He had this cardboard that says he needed something for, had almost all his rent, but he just needed, I don't remember exactly how much, it wasn't much, maybe $150 or something. And he said, I'm hungry, I'll work if you'll give me something to do. People just driving past here. There is no concern that God is observing you. So how did you feel? Did you think, there goes some of them homeless people wanting to ask, begging for money? You could be homeless before it's all said and done. You could be. There's a lot of people that's on the street today that ain't always been on the street. Some of them had a place to live. Some of them had a job. You could be reduced to the same thing, except you think you're so high minded. I'm not stopping giving them nothing. Who knows what they're going to do with the money? Don't worry about it. You just do what's right. You do what's right. But we fear God enough not to just put people down that's on the street. These are God's people. Let's get a wake-up call here. You know, what can I do? I don't want to rub God the wrong way. I don't want him to be upset with me because I didn't take a moment. Take a moment. Don't take long. I'm going to do something good. What you sow, you reap. What you put out there is coming back to you, good or bad. You're going to reap it. Maybe it didn't happen in your day, but after you were dead and gone, one of your children needed something and nobody would help them. It falls back on what the parents didn't do. That's a fact. So take a look and say, you know what? The way I look at it, these people, they need to get off the street. Give them a place to stay. They're not sitting on the street because that's what they like to do, but rather because they have no choice. Take a moment. If you understand nothing else, understand that we are under observation every day in what we say, in what we do, how we act every day. Some way, somehow, God is dealing with you why people don't fear God? They don't even really believe he's up there. But if you believe everything I'm doing, he's paying attention to it, I'm going to be careful how I deal with it, what I say. Because God will judge you for the wrong that you've done to somebody, that you didn't treat somebody right. When you could have done something good, you chose not to. Take a moment and say, I just want to please God. If you please him, you don't have to worry about being upset with him. But if you fear him, you will please him. You be careful what you do and what you say. It is important that we understand the danger in living our lives so close to the edge and not in one time considering that how does God feel about this? I want to know. Everything I do in the ministry has to be done in this frame of mind. How does this affect the members of our church? How does it affect me as a spiritual leader in the community? Everything is about how is this going to pan out? If I can't see that this can work, I'm talking about not nothing wrong, but can it have a negative effect? No, can't do it. And God is looking at you to see what your decision was. How did you deal with that? If you thought God was right here in front of you, looking at you, and when you get ready to start lying, you would check yourself. Well, he's right there. He's not some faraway place, and he ain't seeing it or observing us. Man is might as well be in a position where we're being watched, going where you go. See what you see, say what you say. Not good. You're in a position. God is observing you to see how you're dealing with what I did, what I give you. And how did you handle that when this particular situation happened? How did you handle that? No fear of God. Well, I'm not going to worry about it. Yeah, I said it, and I ain't taking it back. Wait a minute. You may have to. This man went to church one time and said, if God come down here and mess with me, I'll kick him in his rear. But he used another word. He raised his feet back to demonstrate it. It never came down again. Can you imagine walking around with your foot in a kick position for the rest of your life? Because you didn't take a moment. Don't do this. Don't threaten God. Don't try to tell if he don't do this for me. You better go sit down. The way I look at it, I deserve. You don't deserve nothing. Even what we get every day, if we live right every day, it's not because we deserve anything that God is good to us. No. You ain't going to be able to do enough. Let all the earth, David said, fear the Lord. Oh, everybody here, fear him. Think about it. Judges, prosecutors, and all these people who do people wrong, they have no fear of God. Because Samuel's put it this way. He said, men that rule over men must first have the fear of God. Because if you don't fear God, you'll do people bad. Just because you're in some kind of position of authority, watch that stuff. You just kick up and do what you want to do. It's disheartening to me when I look at it. And I'm thinking, you're such a smart aleck. You just want to say whatever you want to say, and that's the way I feel about it. Really? Fear God. Fear God. Don't fear a man who only can destroy this body, and after that, there's no more they can do. But fear God, who can destroy both soul and body, and then cast it into hell. Fear God. We're afraid of all these people. Hey, you look at my boss. Oh, no. I can't say that, because what would happen to my child? No, you know, you go in there and lie to the boss, because I'm trying to keep my job, and lose it anyway. No matter what the position you're in, no matter what type of crisis may come your way, stop for a minute. Don't start blaming the wrong person. You know what man has done from the beginning of time? He's always tried to blame somebody for the things bad that happened in his life. He's always looking for somebody to blame. So if somebody did wrong and God called him on the carpet, Lord, it wouldn't have happened, as Adam and Eve said, if you hadn't gave me this woman. No, I told you what to do. I hold you accountable. You cannot give it to somebody else. Stop for a minute. If you're on the job and somebody is mad with God and talking crap about God, you should, as a Christian, say, you know, you better stop that. You know, something could happen to you because of that. You shouldn't do that. Wait a minute. Say, God, help me to have more fear and reverence for you, that I respect him so much until I will not do anything that I shouldn't do, but rather do the right thing at whatever cost. Whatever the cost is, do it right. If I lose my job, I'm not going to lie on another employee. I'm not going to do that. Why? Because I care. And because I fear God, you don't go around doing wrong to people. Don't do wrong. We never know when we see people lives being ripped apart, what have they done in their life? What have you done that this bad thing is coming to you? You didn't serve God. You didn't live for him. You never reverenced him. You have no fear of his power and what he can do if you don't do what he tells you. Listen to the word and say, I'm going to change that. Quit walking around here making your boast. God hears you. Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. Don't walk around and boast with you. I tell you one thing, no matter what happened to me, I'm not doing so and so. Don't boast, because you don't know what tomorrow will bring. It may bring you something bad because you sold something bad, or it may bring you something good because you did what was right. Think about it. God is not going to ever do something to us when we've done good. I'm going to reward you for evil. He'll never do it. He's a just God. Stop for a minute and say, you know what? I'm going to listen. And I'm going to be careful what I say. Fear the Lord, ye his saints. For there is no want to them that fear him. Why you got want? You don't fear God. Why you lack? You don't fear God. Because he said to the righteous, there is no want. There is no lack. So when you see the people of God in want and lacking, it's because they didn't do something right. Think about that. I need to be more concerned and watch myself that I don't do things that I shouldn't do. The transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of God before his eyes. For he flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquity be found to be hateful. The people that's unsaved, that sin every day, they're not concerned whether God is paying attention. But he is. You're not going to get away with it no matter how you try. Change the way you do things. When you come in church, just don't come in any kind of way. I've seen people get uptight with maybe one of the ushers in the church and slam out and nasty and rude. Not good. If you don't like something here, that's why we have a door that opens both ways. It'll let you in, the same door will let you out. You don't have to get out. Nobody tell me what to do and treat me like I'm this, I'm that. Just go on. Either do it or get out. You don't have to get mad with nobody because they don't agree with you. We've had some people sometimes to come in with some clothes on that you wouldn't even wear to the club. I'm talking everything showing. Everything showing. And I'm trying to understand, where is the love or fear for God that lets you walk in his house looking like a whore? Like, I need to fix myself up. Where's my Sunday go to meeting clothes? They don't have no Sunday go to meeting because they don't go to meeting on Sunday. See? Think about it. Don't get mad with us. We say there's a dress code out there. All we ask you to do is respect it. You know why we put it out there? Honey, the stuff that was coming in here was repulsive. I mean, boobs, hey, clothes cut down with all the boobs shaking like a bowl of Jell-O. And then they got a short skirt on that's hitting them way up. I'm talking, they didn't have to bend over for you to see the panty line. I'm thinking, you in church. Do you think that's okay? There are clubs and grocery stores that won't let you in looking like that. That's the truth. There is restaurants that say, no, you can't wear tennis shoes in here, or you can't come in barefooted. They have a code. And then they get mad sometime with our husband. We say, honey, can we help you to do something? No, I like what I got on. Well, go ahead. Go ahead. You can keep liking it. But you're not going to switch your rear end around this table up here and when it's time to take the offering to see if somebody's looking at you. I think, what did you come to church for? Did you come because you wanted to meet with God, or you looking for somebody? Because you wearing the part. You weren't. Get mad. Don't pay to do that. I'm getting ready to close this message, but Reverend Bradford, when I was in Tacoma, this girl got mad with him because he told her the truth that he was in the pulpit getting ready to preach. And this girl came in. She was mad at him, and she came in the church, and she came down the middle aisle where he was standing, and she said, you don't tell me what to do, preacher. I had this sharp butcher knife because I would cut you. She told him what she would do to him and everything, and as came toward him, he said, he told the church, he said, pray that God will bind this, and he prayed. And she stood at the front of the a communion table cursing the preacher out in the house of God. Not because he did her wrong, but rather because he told her the truth. She left the church with her knife, got in the car with her friends, go down the freeway between Tacoma and Seattle, and suddenly an accident happened. What was strange about it, the car didn't hit nothing or nobody. The car somehow started spinning in a circle, and people were hollering, her friends trying to get out of this situation. How did this happen? There's no truck, there's no traffic cutters, there's no nothing. Why is this? The freeway ended up with this huge hole in it. The car turns upside down in the hole, and they have to pull it out, and not one person was hurt except that girl who had cursed that preacher out. She was dead. You can't get away with it. She had no fear of God to come in there and curse a preacher out. No fear of God. And God said, oh, I'll stop you. I don't want your friends. I want you. He can get you in the middle of everybody else around you if he wants to, because he is a sure shooter. When he lets loose his arrow of wrath, it doesn't miss. It's going to get the people he sent it for. Them people were scared to death. They're trying to act. How did she die? Nobody else is even hurt, period. But this girl is dead at the scene. She went into a church and cursed the preacher out and told him what she would do to him. She had no fear of God. Consequences are great. If you're sitting here this morning, you don't fear God, and you think you can say and do anything you want to when you want to do it. If you don't know something for sure, don't take nobody's word for it. People love to gossip. They love to say, you know, I heard about her, honey. Did you hear this? So I don't want to hear nothing. I ain't got time for no gossip. Go on. Because I ain't so stupid if I go over there to Sister Rose's church that if she's a phony, it don't take long to find it out. It don't take long to find it out. Why do I need you to school me? For some reason, you left because you didn't like what she said. Most people leave this church don't like truth. And I'm going to tell you the truth no matter whether you like it or not. I don't care. Here it is. So when they get mad, they go outside that door and say, honey, I never believed in her no way. Do you know what I heard about her? I said, baby, don't involve me. Because if I want to go over there, I'll find out for myself. I don't need you to inform me. I'm an adult. I can go in a place, and if it ain't right, it ain't going to take you long. I'm as transparent as they get. You wouldn't be here in no time, but you find out, wow, you'll wow yourself all the way out that door. Wow. You ever heard anything like that? Wow. Yeah, but it's going to be truth. I ain't never lied on anybody in my life since I've been saved. I have no need to. If you can't tell the truth about people, don't tell nothing. If you don't know the story for sure with the evidence supporting it, don't tell a lie. Don't believe it. No, I'm not going to believe it. And you know what I found out? Preachers who hate preachers who tell the truth, they always say something negative about that preacher. And I don't care. Ask me if I care. You can say anything you want about me because God got his day. He's going to rip your tongue out. He got a day. He's going to take care of it. Don't worry about it. Just keep on doing what's right. Right always wins out. No matter what people say about you, no matter how they try to put you down, don't worry about it. It's going to rule out. See, you got a time. Everything comes to the forefront. Just take your time. Don't get involved. Hold on. See, I don't want nobody telling me about anybody. I'll find out for myself. But the problem with people, we love gossip. You say, what, girl? No, that other thing you just said. What was that? It's going to make you take a back step. No. About that, you know, because you said it, yeah. Tell me something else about that. We love hearing bad, negative things about people. You tell them something good, they say, child, I don't even believe that. She said that's what they do, child, I don't believe it. They said, Sister Rose, I said, I don't believe it. Well, honey, what I heard, don't buy it. Fear God enough to say, don't tell me. If I want to like this woman, if I think she's for real and I want to go over there, I don't need you to show me why I shouldn't go. You could have a whole bunch of lies about this preacher. Boy, they tell some good ones. I thought, come on. God's going to get every one of them. I don't have to worry about getting them. He's going to take care of it. Yes. Let me tell you, I've heard some stories and I think, wow. That had to come from hell. That's so crazy. Doesn't make sense. I think one of the most horrendous lies was, do you know, child, Sister Rose goes in the audience and take off all the women's jewelry for herself and she keeps it. Come on. You would be stupid to let me come out in the audience, take your necklace and your earring. I don't wear earrings, but just take your necklace or whatever. And go back to the pulpit. I say, how did the devil get that lie up? I take all y'all jewelry. You could ask any member of this church. They still have their jewelry. I don't want their jewelry. They don't even have my taste anyway. But if they did, I don't want your stuff. That's so stupid. Honey, you got to wear a lace in that church. Lace? Was she trying to figure out lace? I don't know if anybody, ain't many people in here I think got lace on this morning. But that's what they do. And honey, they all wear wigs. Because you know what? Her daughter's got a wig shop. And? But if they did, why is it a problem? Why is it a problem? Honey, you have to have a Visa MasterCard to go to that church. Really? I haven't ever seen anybody's Visa or Master. Ain't never seen it. Child, she'll break up your marriage. Not true. And why would I break up your marriage? Most people that break up marriages have a motive. Yeah. I wasn't looking for no man. I was married for 34 years, happily married, till the Lord took my husband home 22 years ago, and I'm still happy. Yeah. I still ain't looking for, I mean, they had me engaged just 3 months after my husband was married, 3 months. I hear Sister Rose is engaged. You just heard a lie. 22 years later, and one man came to the church, came outside the door, and said, Sister Rose, where are your Rolls Royces? I said, that's another lie. Yeah. I don't even like Rolls Royces. I don't like the body or the shape of them. But I ain't buying no Rolls Royce. Yeah, she got some stuff. She got land down in Florida all along the coast. I said, tell them to tell me where it's at because I didn't know I had it. So I could get down there. Why am I paying to stay in a hotel when I got land all along the coast? Stupid! And you know what? It's amazing to me how stupid people are to believe it. and sued me and said, honey, I'm getting that land. You can't get it. I don't have it. Mental-minded, depraved, ignorant, stupid, unbelievable, dumb people. Don't worry about it. Just keep going. God's going to bring you through. Oh, does he ever? You can live with that. You don't have to run around the city trying to find somebody who's going to believe you. I don't care whether you believe them or me. It's Masnicks. That's German. It's Masnicks. Don't care. So this morning, if you're sitting in this place and you say, Sister Rose, you know what? I'm one of them gossiping people. I talk about everybody's business and all this stuff. And you know what? And I must don't fear God at all. I run down preachers and everybody else. If you've ever wronged somebody and you did it just because you were an evil, mean person, you need to repent and ask God to forgive you for it. And we're going to have prayer up here this morning. If you want to come up and say, Lord, forgive me, I'll pray for you. He will forgive you. He forgave me 55 years ago. And I am grateful today that I'm still here doing it right. You don't have to be temporarily doing it right. You can do it right permanently. So our musicians are coming forward. If you're sitting there this morning, say, Sister Rose, I want you to pray for me. I need prayer. I need help. I just dislike some folks just for the heck of disliking them. I talk about everybody. And everybody's talking about you. Keep moving. So if you're there this morning, you need prayer, you need to give your heart to the Lord and say, Lord, here I am. Change me. He'll do it. I don't have to be that way. I bet you there ain't a new person sitting in this building this morning hadn't heard something negative before you got here. You going where? Oh, let me tell you. Say, that's okay, baby. I'll find out real soon. You'll find out I'm just the opposite of everything they say that I am. That's why I remember stay here, because they love Sister Rose. Sister Rose. Sister Rose is the real thing. Yes. So while our musicians are singing and playing, if you'd like to come forward for us to pray for you, we will gladly do so. Some can line up here. I will be here. There'll be another minister on this side to pray for you. Please come forward if you desire. God bless you.